gentlemen, welcome to this afternoon's praise party. 1, 2, 3, go!
Thank you. I like to get around and speak to everyone. Did you remember that? And Michael, you very kindly wrote some words for David Jones, which were read in his wife's funeral. And that was really a sensitive sign that was very much appreciated for us. And we are very grateful for both of your contribution ministry to the cause. So I thank you for the 3 years that I've been here, but there are people here who would like to thank you for the years that they've known you, not just as fellow journeyers, but as friends. And we have a little card, and we have a small monetary gift. It's actually dollars. So we do have you now to buy something. We didn't feel that we could buy something because you're joining 2 days together and it has to get to Australia, and we thought maybe you could purchase something as a reminder of the fellowship here. So we'd like to thank you, and I'd like to like our fellowship to stand, and we'd like to say a prayer for you. And we're going to ask the lady with the fat, the camera, when after we've said the prayer, we're going to go down there, and she's going to come up here, and we're going to take a picture of all the fellowship waving with you in the front. Is that okay? And we're going to put that out there. So shall we just say it? And dear Lord Jesus, we just thank you for Barry and for Michael. We just thank you for their ministry within this call. But we do pray that you continue to bless and be with them as they move to Australia. We do pray that you will just enable the move to go smoothly, and Lord, that they will feel safe in your care. Lord, we just thank you for Barry and Michael today and pray your blessing upon them. Amen.
Amen.
I'm sure we'd like to.
Thank you.
We as a group of people sharing with you this weekend stand alongside you in celebrating our faith and the assurance that God's love and protection will be with us always. So can we stand now, before we pray, raise our voices together to celebrate and affirm our faith by singing the song In Christ Alone.
Thank you. today we pray for Staple Hill Corps. You know their hopes, their dreams, their challenges. And Lord, right now, we ask you to pour out your spirit in this place and to guide your people as they seek to be your hands in this community.
Lord, always help us to trust in you, to be steadfast when times are tough, and to celebrate the sense of victory that comes when we're able to see others coming into the knowledge of your soul-saving grace. At this time, we ask for your arms of love and comfort for those who are in this fellowship who may be struggling. Your intervention in the challenging situations we see unfolding daily across the world, and your encouragement for us as we seek to do your will. As this body of your people joins together this weekend, let us all find challenge and inspiration in what is shared, what is still to come, and a strong sense of fellowship. We ask you to allow your Holy Spirit to flow through everything that takes place this afternoon, and that your message will speak to each and every one of us. We ask in your name.
It's been great to share with you already this afternoon and throughout the weekend. And already we're all praying for the hall cleaner, aren't we? It's a team effort, don't worry. It's been great to share. And for us, it's really a real blessing and privilege to come to your court, because it means that actually we can be able to unite Salvation Brass with Staple Hill. And that really is to Neil and Laura, especially. And Neil has worked tirelessly for this weekend, and I'm sure you'd like to show your appreciation to him for all his work. The thing is with Neil that, you know, when you ask him to do something, you know it's going to get done. So at 20-4, when I said to him, Neil, have you got the score to the Pioneers? And he looked at me and said, yes. I said, great, because I'd like you to conduct it. He was quite pleased about that menial task that suddenly given. So, but we're going to, Neil's going to come and conduct the group. We're going to play the March of the Pioneers. But actually, the other thing is to keep an eye on the screen, because we've had a great weekend. I hope you'd share that sentiment with us. We really enjoyed being with you and amongst you. And actually, what you'll see is a little bit of an insight as to what's happened here at Staple Hill this weekend.
Thank you. sing for us the song, Look at the Well. Thank you so much for this conversation.
Thank you.
songsters. Beautiful vocal sound, wasn't it? Reminding us again of all the goodness that comes from God. All that is around us, God is responsible for, and all that we have. And it's represented here, all the bounty of God, all the provision that He makes for us. So thank you, songsters. And we're going to have a brief word with Ian. If Ian would like to join me. And we're going to ask Ian to tell us about himself and a bit of a testimony time. So, welcome, Ian.
Thank you.
Thanks for agreeing to talk to me in this way. Would you like to introduce yourself? Tell them who you are, where you're based, what you're doing with your time, that kind of thing.
Good afternoon, all. My name's Ian. I come from the Disc Corps, which is over in Norfolk, so quite a few miles from here. I came to the Salvation Army through the, I like to call it the William Booth method. I was a board Methodist. So around about 25 years ago, I had an idea it would be good to start attending the army on a Sunday evening. And from there, that's where I am now. I am the bandmaster at the Disc Corps and have been for the last 8 years, but have played in the band all the time that I've been at the Corps.
Okay. And in all the things that you're doing at the Corps and at work, whatever, wherever that might be, can you tell us about some evidence or show us some evidence of God's goodness in your life right now?
Yeah. For a job or for a career, I work for a small retailer called Marks and Spencer's. And I've worked for them for the last nearly 20 years now, and prior to that I'd spent a number of years serving Her Majesty the Queen as a lifeguard musician, so the ones that ride the horses. And even though I'm sitting on the corner bench, during my army career I was a clarinet player. Can't get much different than that, but I was. Part of what does God do and how does it work for me? Well, I stand before you now as a happy Christian and a happy person. But what you won't see, unless you had the unlucky circumstances I took my shirt off, was I actually suffer with Crohn's disease. And that's obviously a debilitating bowel problem, sadly. And I was diagnosed with that back in the middle 90s. And one of the problems you get with that is every so often, everything likes to shut down. And one of the occasions was in the year 2000. I spent 3.5 months in hospital. And that's really a tough thing to do for somebody who's normally quite active. I stand here quite happily saying I'm one of those few people that has permission to be slightly overweight. Fortunately, I'm 6'2", so I can carry that weight. But when with Crohn's, I can lose weight extremely quickly. If I could bottle it for the Slim and World people, you'd be so pleased. But I can lose, the last time I was really ill, I lost 3 stone in just over 3 weeks. It can be done, sadly. And the problem with that is when everything shuts down, it basically leaves you completely exhausted, no energy, nothing that you can do. And so I spent 3 months in the West Suffolk Hospital at Bury St Edmunds, basically trying to find out, A, what was wrong. They already knew what was wrong, fortunately. I'd got an illness. But why it was happening. And after 3 months of tests and basically becoming the longest and youngest inpatient they'd had for ages, I had a massive operation where basically, and I don't like to put it like this, but everything was taken out. It was all laid around the operating theatre. And then they straightened it out like a garden hose, basically. Like you put your hose away for the winter. They straightened it all up, and then I knew I'd be okay when I came out in there. So what it was, when you lay in a hospital bed on your own for 3 months, even with all the friends and everything popping in and all the nurses coming in at night, and that sounds really wrong, but we used to have some lovely chats in the middle of the night. Sorry. I love the story. I can tell you some stories. You have your conversations with God. Now, we talk about prayer and we talk about, what can God do for me? But at certain times, you really do need to work to ask personally, what can you do for me? And it sounded horrible because they had me laying on this in this bed in this room. And then in the room next door was sadly the room where all the people who were at the end of their time were being taken. And I went, once I've got to 50-odd people, I started to close my door because it was obvious that every single person that was being pushed into there, when they were wheeled out, had sadly gone to see the Maker. So I was praying quite heavily, and then eventually, it sounds horrible, but I changed consultants. And I went from an old traditional wearing a white coat person to a younger, you know what, we'll try anything type person. And that was, for one thing, my answer to prayer. Because apart from laying there and being on all the medication you could think of, they'd got no clue what they could do to make me better. Whereas Dan, my consultant, just said, hey, we'll try anything. I've got time if you've got time. Well, I'm laying in hospital. I've got nowhere to go. And that was my first real time when I went, you know what, this is my answer to prayer. When you do ask for something, God can actually deliver. And that really worked in my life.
My work.
My job is the health and safety department for Marks and Spencers. We're making it better. The rules are simplifying. Everybody will get that. We'll catch up with the army at some point. But my job sees me deal day in, day out with people that normally, you know, hopefully they're all okay. There's a few people that are taken ill and that type of thing. But I see people day in, day out that sadly had accidents or falls, and you know, you can work with them. On my personal life, I don't want to go on too long for you, but the last sort of 5 years have been a real challenge in my personal life. Without saying it, 5 years ago, I had no house, and I had 49p to my name. And that was through circumstances, so we won't dwell on that. But one of the things that I did was, you know the old saying of, right, I'll pull my socks up, yeah? And through the support from the Corps and friends and everything, I sort of said, right, let's get on with my life. And for one thing, my health has improved. Prior to that, I was visiting the hospital every couple of weeks or every 4 weeks, and I was getting blood infusions and iron infusions. I'm virtually off my medication now. Through my choice, but I am. And obviously, the guys know, there'll be an announcement at some point once certain things happen, but I've met somebody that I really want to be with, which is great. And friends that you gain through the music community is, you know, what I want to do. It's great serving your own personal, your own core. It's great serving your community. And when you cross that over between the job that you do or the work that you do, but it's also then being great to be able to get out. And, you know, every single one here doesn't now think of the 4 or 5 hour journey that they might have to go home, or how, you know, tiring the weekend's been. We will go home with an uplift ourselves. This is what we enjoy doing. We enjoy this every Sunday in our own cause, but when we get together as a group, and we are a family group, we love meeting up, catching up, solving our own problems. You know, there's certain people, they're not here today, but you wouldn't have, you know, known what was going on in the band last night for some people's, you know, what was going on in their private lives. But collectively, we're always talking on, you know, social media nowadays, just saying, what's my problem? What's going on? But that's where, you know, God works in your life. You can actually say to him, right, you brought me down to your lowest level, and we've all been there. And then you say, right, to a point, how are you going to help me? And then part of it is realizing, how am I going to help myself? And collectively, you know, God helps no end with that. And that's where I now stand here happily, very happy, and you know, enjoying my life, enjoying my health. So here I can stand here and go, hey, I'm actually overweight, probably for the wrong reasons now, but you never know, I've got to be cautious. But it's great to be able to stand here and say hello to you, to profess how happy I am in my private life, but also with my God life, my life with the Lord, And in the corps that I work with, we've gone for a year where we've had no officers. We've had to step up as a local officers community and lead meetings and all those sort of things that you do. And it's not necessarily in your comfort zone, but you learn how do I profess my love for the Lord with regards to you guys who are sat down there. And then you learn to, right, I will step up, I will enjoy proclaiming God's love in a manner that hopefully everybody else starts to enjoy. And if that means sitting down here playing or talking or just putting an arm around a shoulder occasionally for somebody at work, especially if they're at the end, you know, they've had a bad day, I'm a really good listener. That's the one thing you get. You don't bear grudges or anything like that. If I need to listen, I will listen. And you can talk for as long as you want, and I'm quite happy to do that.
Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us better times? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill my heart with joy when their grain and new wine abound. You have given me greater joy than those with great harvests of grain and new wine. So I will lie down in peace and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. This morning we looked at how our joys and our sorrows are connected by God's goodness. How that connection can transform our mourning into dancing, our sorrow into joy, and our captivity into freedom, and our sickness into health. God is that God of transformation. His goodness connects those things, so we're never lost in sorrow. We always have joy connected with it because of our God. But before David got into that mourning into dancing thing in Psalm 30, he wrote this psalm. And this is, in case you're wondering, this is David from David and Goliath, famous story, but also he grew up to be King David, the greatest of all Israel's kings, ancestor of Jesus, no less. And this is David writing in Psalm 4. But some of the words that we saw this morning, that we heard this morning, was David saying, when I was prosperous, in other words, when I had everything I needed, I said to myself, nothing can stop me now. This is David writing in Psalm 30. He felt invincible. Because of all that he had in that moment. He thought because God had given him everything he needed right then, he felt like nothing could stop him. Nothing could bring him down. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt that you've got all your ducks lined up, everything's there, everything's good, everything's great at the moment, nothing could possibly pierce that joy that you're feeling? This is the view that mainstream culture has of joy, that when you have everything that you want or that you need, that's when you have joy. We're just going to watch a brief clip from Disney.
Ever wonder why you feel the way you do? Well, get to know your emotions. When everything in your life is going your way, that's when joy takes control. This is joy. With an unstoppable spirit and unbeatable energy, joy brings a smile to your face and, oh, who cares? Let's party! Get to know all your emotions with Disney Pixar's Inside Out, rated PG.
I want happiness and I want it now. Where can I find it? Those are the people saying, who will show us better times? This morning we heard that often the harvest of joy is sown in tears. There's no instant joy crop. There's no cup of joy that you can just add hot water to. Joy is not available live stream on demand via Wi-Fi that people try and find it there. A harvest of joy, if we're to believe David and we do, a harvest of joy must be cultivated. It's hard won through absolute trust. A harvest of joy is cultivated and hard won through absolute trust in God and God alone. It's won in the moments when the good times aren't rolling. It's one in the moments when we feel like God is far away, but we still trust. It's one of those moments on the hospital bed. It's one of those moments feeling like you're in exile. It's one of those moments when you don't know where your life is headed. It's one in those moments when you still trust. Many people say, who will show us better times, he says. And then he says, you, Lord, have given me greater joy than those who have abundant harvest of grain. In peace, I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, O Lord, will keep me safe. That is trust. That is absolute trust. That you are even willing to close your eyes and let the world pass you by because you are so rested in the security of God. Here is a joy that has been grown and harvested from a deep seated peace and contentment. A heart that knows that in the face of constant change, a heart that knows in seasons of struggle that God is constant, that his love is unfailing, and his hope is eternal. Let me say that one more time. Here is a joy that has been grown and harvested from a deep-seated peace and contentment. A heart that knows that in the face of constant change and seasons of struggle, that God is constant, his love is unfailing, and his hope is eternal. So although joy sometimes looks like fun and laughter, and if we had time to look at the story of Nehemiah and see the words used there, we talked about it in prayers earlier with the guys, the word joy there means gleefulness and mirth, and that can be the way that joy is expressed, but it's just as accurate to say that deep peace is like being able to let your shoulders drop, breathe deeply, to be still and know that God is God and I am not. To feel the warmth of his love wrapped around you, sinking into the comfort of knowing God is there. That's the kind of joy that really is the source of all our strength. And our prayer is that we will all be able to experience that cultivated sense of deep, deep joy, no matter what's going on around us, and that will be there at the core of our being. Let me pray for you. Oh Lord, we have a world that advertises joy for sale. Instant joy. We pray that we will not be fooled by the lures of the world that would fool us into thinking that joy can be found in those places when we know that joy can only be found in you, true lasting joy. We pray, Lord, that not only will we find that joy for ourselves, but we also will be able to share our knowledge of that joy so that we can bring others to know of it, so that we can protect our children from the false joy of the world and bring them into a knowledge of you that is deep and lasting and unbreakable and unshakable. Lord, may we each have that deep, trusting, knowing relationship with you that cultivates a harvest of real, lasting joy. Lord, we pray your blessing upon all those of us here, our families and loved ones, that we all might rest secure.
Throughout this weekend. sections, so the YP band, who did a great job this afternoon, and we really appreciate that, and also the songsters as well. For last evening, I'd like to thank Hilton and his group of trustees for putting on such a fantastic concert in this place, and raising a phenomenal amount of money. So really, congratulations must go to you for arranging such a great night. And you know, we obviously encourage all you continue to do in and through the Kenya Trust. And finally, Salvation Brass. I'd like to thank them, of course. I'm not going to thank anyone individually because, as being a founder member of Salvation Brass back in 2008, I know that it is a real team effort. And this group comes together each and every time they do with the hope that all of you guys will leave uplifted and blessed. And as Ian alluded to in his testimony there, it's the same for these guys as well. They come to worship, and it's the case that they want to sort of bring us all into the presence of God. So, but I would thank you all overall for all that you've done for us at Staple Hill this weekend, really sincerely. And I'd just like us all to kind of finish this with an applause, but I'd like us to all just give it back to the Lord in thanks for all that he has done for us. Thank you very much. And if I have forgotten to thank anyone and you feel left out, please email me at dean.jones. But seriously, thank you all. Thank you all so much for having us. We've enjoyed our time here. So well, let me pronounce a benediction for you. May you go in deep peace, resting in the knowledge that God is always with you. That he is always working through all circumstances for your good. May you go in the deep experiential knowledge of Jesus Christ. Know that he is walking with you, that he is going ahead of you, that he is preparing a way for you and preparing a home for you. May you walk in the inner strength of the Holy Spirit. Know his power, know his love, know his guarantee of your future hope within your life. May Jesus Christ bless each of us and go with us as we separate this afternoon. May his blessing be upon us. Amen. Something of a tradition, the Salvation Brass, that we also give you a musical benediction. So we're just going to take our places around the hall, and we're going to play for you one final piece of music.